Now the next presenter is Dr. Alok Das from IIPR, Kanpur, and he would be making a presentation on the efforts and strategies for elevation of drought tolerance in chickpea in India. Dr. Alok Das.
Thank you very much. At the outset, I must thank the organizer for giving me the opportunity to present on behalf of IIPR Kanpur. What I'm going to present is a work of IIPR Kanpur along with other collaborating partners of CG Institute like ICRISAT, ICARD and others. So I'm going to tell in a very brief, our efforts and strategies for enhancement of drought tolerance in chickpea. It's a major crop in India. I'm going to talk in a very brief about the integrated breeding approach, which we follow at our institute at IIPR Kanpur. It's the pre-breeding, as you all know, for growing the lines meant for crossing, and then conventional breeding, and then very important breeding for desirable plant architecture. As the time changes, with the change in the climate, we need to build a new plant architecture with novel trait suited to particular niches. Marker-assisted breeding, of course, a very important approach. My earlier speakers have already shown. Allele mining, you need to mine more genes, find out more genes from wild species and relatives to find out exactly whether there are better form of the genes. And then transgenic technology and nanotechnology, a brief. So if we look at the production of the pulses and chickpea in particular, we see the production is either stagnant or it has gone down in the last two years or so. And particularly in case of chickpea, and this is mainly due to the chickpeas grown in mostly in the rain-fed condition. More than half of the area is in under rain-fed condition. It has evolved under harsh growing environments and then vagaries of the monsoon. It takes a heavy toll on the chickpea production. Intermittent high temperature during the growth stages of the chickpea, and then very less dew in the soil, which really hampers its growth in the crucial stages where it needs life-saving irrigation. So we need to take up appropriate adaption research strategies to address those issues. So if you see the rainfall pattern of the last 100 years in India, you see for the last couple of decades, the pattern has been very, very erratic. Mostly it is either nil or in a negative. That is, we are water deficient. And we need to address this issue by breeding for drought tolerance in these valuable pulses. So how can we do this? We need to tap the variation which is available in the gene pool. And then also we need to see for the highest ability. And then also create variability in those so that we can use them in the breeding programs. So these are the particularly three ways by which we can do it: plant genetic resources and the mutation breeding and transgenic technology. This is a few glimpses of what we have been doing. We have been maintaining the collection of the genetic resources from various parts of India and other countries, of course, and to see how they have been doing under drought condition. And during the last year, we have identified 3 to 4 lines, which is quite promising to drought tolerance. So this is a glimpse of wide hybridization garden we have been maintaining at IIPR Kanpur. We have around 2,000 accessions in the coal module with us, and then 6 wild species particularly, which are highly adapted, having 120 accession and 188 land races. We need to phenotype those traits along with some new traits. So this is a trait, this is a wild species of chickpea. As you all know, chickpea has only 2 seeds at maximum, the cultivated chickpea. This is a wild species of chickpea, Sisar cuneatum, which has got 6 seeds, and these are highly adapted to drought. So this possibly can be a very useful donor for our breeding program, and we have been trying to cross these lines with the cultivated varieties so that the drought tolerance trait can be brought in our cultivated genotypes. This lower side shows that how the architecture of the chickpea plants has been changed. We need to have erect plant type so that mechanical harvesting can be done, and there is a maximum exposure to albedo. These are the wild species which you have been maintaining at IIPR, Pinnatifidium, Judaicum, Echinospermum, Reticulatum, and Prussicum. In the primitive land races, there is a huge variability, which has been shown right from the first flower to 50% flowering, 50% budding, and days to maturity. There is a huge variability, and we need to tap on those variability if we need to improve the chickpea. There is a particular example of a land race, we call it ILC01, which has been collected from 14 countries around the world. And you can see how a single land race, single accessions from different countries, how they vary in various parameters, days to 50% flower, plant height, seed weight, indicating there is a tremendous genetic variation in the chickpea germplasm which it needs to utilize. So for screening for drought tolerance, we see that beyond 36 degree, there is a sterility in the chickpea plants, and the pollen really fails to germinate. So these are again the wild sizer species, and these are the few varieties. These are the few varieties which has released from IIPR in the last couple of years to find out. Again, there is not only tremendous variability in the germplasm, there is also tremendous variability in season within India. So we need to harness that, and accordingly, we can take 2 to 3 crops in a season. This is a QTL which has been identified from microsat, and we are trying to introgress through marker assisted selection program. This is the current breeding program going on for importing drought tolerance and other valuable characteristics. Allele mining we have done for a very important gene CAP2. It is called a homologue of the DREB gene, and we have tried to see that there is a very less variability in the allele. The genetic engineering, these are the few strategies of the genetic engineering, how the drought stress perceive, and it is mostly the post-transcriptional regulation which really matters. We also have attempted some to get some transgenic chick with the AT DREB 1A, and these are the phenotyping result. The quantum mill, the figure of the quantum mill shows that the transgenic lines are far superior than the control DCP92-3, coupled to higher relative water content, the chlorophyll value, the electron transport rate. This is very, very important. The photosynthesis has to be continued on those lines if we want to survive under drought condition. These are the electron transport rates, and the transgenic line shows quite higher electron transport rates compared. This is the water use efficiency done through carbon isotope discrimination. And you can see the transgenic lines are far better in case of water use efficiency. And these are the phenotype of the plants. Nanotechnology is a very recent beginning for us. We used a wool pyrolyzed product, and we call it water soluble carbon nanoions. And this is how it looks. This is the multilayered onions, which you called nano onions, because they are multilayered multition. This is when treated to chickpea, you see the variability. The left is the control, and on the right panel, these are treated with the carbon nanoions. This is how the plant looks. After the treatment, there is a wide variability in the number of seeds and also the size of the seeds. When you do some electron microscopy, we found that these carbon nanoions are embedded in the root tissues. And this really makes the plant, the root architecture, to grow bigger and then more water use efficiency. This is how the seed to seed cycle looks. If you see, this is the control plant. The root part is quite higher in the treated as compared to the control. And not only it's water efficient, if you see, if you have analyzed the seed to seed cycle and the first generation seed,